Well, at least there is one thing that all Christians are unanimous about, and that is that our life together has something to do with the love of God. That we, in fact, have been commanded to love. In other words, it's not a choice on our part. It's what God has created in us to be fulfilled. It's not our first nature, our second nature. It is our only nature. And so the verse goes, based on this text, and they'll know we are Christians by our
love.
That's who we are. Well, what we found out, though, is instantly after we learned this love of love, that the love feast doesn't last too long. And society looks around us as the church today and wonders, yes, they are Christians because they love one another. And at the same time, they look at us and say, I'm not sure they are Christians the way that they don't love each other. For as soon as we agree that we love each other, we find ways to divide each other. I'm not just talking about Christians, but all the rest of the world. And so they look at us and they say, how can that be love if it means rejecting their brothers and sisters, tearing them apart, excluding themselves from each other? How can this be love? Yes, as Christians, we've agreed on love, but we haven't agreed on all the definitions of love, and who and how we are to love one another, and who gets included in God's love, and who can love whom within the bounds of God's love. Well, in a variety of ways, it is Jesus who has communicated to us a tough and yet tender message of the love that is not only in his words, but in the way he related and acted with every person that he encountered. His Jewish biblical roots told him that the genuine essence of life and faith were bound inextricably to the inseparable commands as we know. To love God with our entire being, everything that we are and everything we possess, and to love our neighbor with the identical love with which God has loved us. For if everyone loved their neighbor just like God loves us, then the commonwealth of God's love and justice, grace, and peace would exist in real time. Here and now, heaven would be consuming earth. Well, in one way or another, every one of us has experienced the love of God. Every one of us, in some way, in fashion, knows that we want to say thank you for the love of God to our God. Every one of us, I imagine, has also experienced love from one neighbor, or found love by loving the neighbor. Anybody? Can I get an amen?
Amen.
That's why we're here. We know this stuff's real, but at the same time, we know how tough it is to love as Christ has loved us. And so Jesus and the authors of the scriptures and the way that we organize the teaching cycles in the church always are going to bring us back to those words that we hear them over and over again, as Jesus told the disciples more than once or twice or thrice. I give you this new commandment. As if you're hearing it for the very first time, because I know in some ways you probably forgot it already. I give you this new commandment. Love one another. Just as I have loved you, you are to love one another. We know these words were spoken just to the disciples 2,000 years ago. They're being spoken right now, in this moment, in this magical, mystical, holy moment, where God finds us together. But always the questions arise, well, what did Jesus mean by love? Who was he referring to when he says that we're to love one another? Whereas Jesus was even asked by the teacher of the law, who next my neighbor? Do we really have to love everyone? Is that really even possible? And our answer is yes. Because that's why we're here. Jesus has shown us what it means to be fully human. He's shown to us already that somebody, as a fully human person, can love everything. as long as we understand what the law is all about. And so he gives us this clue at the start. I want you to love one another just as I have loved you. So how did Jesus love? Well, first of all, he blew up with his heart, his mind, and compassion for the divine spark that he knew was in each individual that he encountered. It had nothing to do with a feeling of attraction or affection because he necessarily liked the other person. But regardless of how he felt, he began with that theological premise that the person before him, be they friend, family, stranger, alien, enemy, adversary, still carried that same divine spark within them. They were a valued creation of God. Jesus' love is not defined or qualified by a sense of liking somebody or agreeing with somebody, but a common God's only presence within that person, standing right there in front of him, in the person throwing stones at him, and even the person nailing nails into his body. He loved not because he liked, but because God was in that other person, regardless of what they were doing. Well, you know, I never give up an opportunity to share a story with my grandchildren. So we have one more this morning. This week it's our granddaughter. We got a video over my cell phone. And it's our daughter, 2.5 years old, Serena, and she is sitting in a yoga position, and she is praying, and she is saying, Namaste. Namaste. Familiar with that word? It comes from the Hindu, Buddhist, and other Asian traditions. And what you do is when you greet a person, when you walk to somebody, the first thing you do is you put your hands together, and you look at them, and you say, Namaste. Now that means I bow to you. In other words, before we've had one word, before we've made any kind of judgments, the first thing I do is recognize the divine spirit in you. That's how Jesus loved. Now that leads us to the second point, is it's not a matter of what we see. You know, Jesus was the one that said, I think the blind people, that's why I have so many stories of blind people see better than those who claim that they do see. Because what has happened is our eyes get in our way, don't they? Because the first thing we do is make snap judgments. We base somebody by their race, their color, their ethnicity, about how they look in their apparel, the way they have dressed themselves, the amount of makeup they put on their faces, the number of pounds they're carrying around on their bodies. We judge them by their odor. We judge them by what they're wearing, be it a turban, be it a hijab, be it anything that's different or odd or different to us. We make these judgments with our eyes. But that's not the way that Jesus loved. We make judgments about each other, and it doesn't matter what race or clan we're from, we all do it. It's not something that just only one people or one race does. But we make these judgments and impressions by limited knowledge and experience of others. And that's our diminishment. Last week at coffee hour, I was given a cup of coffee, and as you know, some of them are all different, they have inscriptions on. And this coffee cup that I got, it said, I make great second impressions. Underneath it, it says, the problem is nobody gets to know it. We tend to make first impression judgments on people and walk away versus starting by, this is a divine reality in front of me, one I am called to love. Jesus loved by always hoping for the best for the others as well, even particularly his adversaries. His words were always direct but never intended to do harm or divide. Rather, his words and actions are meant to enlarge our spirits and our understanding of the grandeur of the possibilities of a larger and greater communion and a more just and loving community among all human beings. That's the vision that he called the kingdom of God, coming on earth as it is in heaven. It's not about one tribe not about one religion, but it's always about every person on God's big earth. Jesus loved always by destroying the barriers of exclusion and superiority. He always challenged phony piety and honored genuine curiosity, those who sought, even though they didn't know, those who doubted, but yet asked. Honoring humility in ways that would create a welcoming and gracious community where everyone was included. For Jesus, God's love was equated with nonviolent protest. He did speak truth to power, powers that oppressed, powers that manipulated, powers that sought to control people, be it within the religious community, but also within the larger empire in which he lived. For Jesus, God's love was about struggle and sacrifice, about getting our egos out of the way long enough to appreciate the beauty and gifts available to us and already there for us in the one that stands before us, even those we have rejected as unacceptable by God. Finally, Jesus equated love to the work of community. We can't love as Jesus loved without being in community. This is why we have been given the church. We can't do it by ourselves. This command to love is our given way of life. It involves then daily practice. It involves intention and attention. It requires discipline to be coupled with that other equal gift of forgiveness of God. For no one ever gets it right all the time. In fact, we are often too blind to see or too stubborn to admit when we get it wrong. And so this remains one of the most important functions of the church. To hold each other accountable in love. To work together for each other, with each other, and not against each other. In honesty and all humility. So that together we might get it right. One of the most clear and concise theological writings I came across in my seminary training was a book by Daniel Day Williams. It's called The Spirit and Forms of Love. He's a process theologian. We won't get into that too deeply. But anyhow, his description of how we understand love is that there is a spirit of love. That's what we can talk about. God's love is the same yesterday, today, and forever. But he said that's not enough. You also have to understand that the forms of God's love, the form that spirit takes place in the reality of the community in the world as it is constantly changing. So in other words, the love of God is the same, but the way that we as Christians have practiced love has always been changing from age to age. In other words, we don't love the way that we did in the first century. Thanks be to God. It's learning today what are the new forms of how God's spirit is alive and to be alive in us. Well, case in point is the story of Acts this morning. We read about how to love one another in John, and now we get to see how it works and how it was working in the first century church, and then what we might learn from that. You ready? These are the Jews. Some of them believe that Jesus was the Messiah. They're convinced of it. Others aren't. But there's still one kind of happy family. Maybe some people aren't sitting with others intentionally, but that doesn't matter. They're still the Jews, and they know who they are. They have the tradition, they have the story. It's been going on for 2,000 years. They recall, they have bloodlines, they go all the way back to
Abraham.
Jews! They're not Jewish. You know the story. You know the family, the living story. You know the journey through the Exodus. You have the daughters of the Egyptian exile as one of the organizations in the community. They don't want to forget that. They don't want to not remember that story. It's in our lives, in our story. There's only 12 tribes. That's how many people are included. We are the chosen people of God, right?
Right.
And all right. And yeah, let's give her credit for Peter, because Peter was a good Jew, and that's what we have to remember. The Christian church started as a Jewish movement. None of you guys were invited, including me. But Peter, remember when God lowers the sheet and he has that vision? And he thinks that God's trying to trick him about eating foods that we know we don't eat as Jews, right? Because we keep ourselves pure and holy. We're different from the rest of those people up there. And so we will not eat those animals because we know that they're profane. Not allowed. Not about who we are. This is why we're unique in the world. We have a promise. Oh. Particularly in this land where we're living, we can deal with these promises. God's promise to us. The rest of you, and you can see where the issue here is, you're all the Gentiles in the world at that time. Okay? So that makes you what?
Minority.
Minority, right? Always have been a minority, always continue to be a minority. Okay? So you're the Gentiles because they know that you don't worship right, you don't eat the right food, you don't dress right, you don't pray right, you don't have the right God name. You're excluded. You're not a part. You're sinners. That's one of the words that was used to define you. Sinners. I mean, it's no fault of your own. Sorry. But you're just out. And so you can't be a part of that story over there. Because you don't love right. You don't marry right. You know, basically, you just don't do anything right. And that's the way that God has parents set up the world. And you just have this nice little group over here. Getting it all right, and you're getting it all wrong. Until God gets into the story, our story of love. Peter is praying, it says, so be careful when you pray. He has this vision, and it's a sheet that comes down, and it's got all these animals on it. And again, Peter thinks this is a pop quiz. Am I going to get this right? It's Yahweh trying to fool me here. All these animals that he was not supposed to be eating. And so he says, Yahweh, no way. God lowers the sheet again. It says three times. Apparently it takes us at least three times to hear something before it starts to sink in. That this isn't about us. This is about God. Now all these people over here knew in their Bibles that you're out. It says right there in the Word, I can show it to you if you want to see it. You're not in this. So what happens? God says, you're not reading the text right. You missed what I was doing. Don't you dare call profane that which belongs to me. God wasn't showing his animals, was he? What was he showing on that sheep? Those are Gentiles he's talking about in that vision. Don't you dare call what I've created profane. And the interesting part in this is that Peter says, he says, they got the same gift that we got. Had nothing to do with Peter, had nothing to do with the early church. It was God's movement to enlarge the circles of love. So then they started the first battle in the church. We've been battling since the beginning, you know. This isn't anything new. But first we thought, okay, all right, you can come in, but you've got to be circumcised. At least that, right? At least that. You've got to do something to change. And God said, what? It's the music of grace that we sang about. This isn't about us. It's not about how the things that we do. It's about commandment to love. And so that was the new form, new form, that God's love was taking in the world. And continues for us to see as a model about the places where we are calling what God has created profane. That which we are ruling out because of our belief in the Bible. But always being trumped by a God who is still speaking. Love one another just as I have loved you. Oh, I entirely forgot to give you the list of the 10 people that did not just go to the lunch today. There is no list. Thanks be to God. May it be so among us. Amen.
Amen.